My conversation today is with Benabel Wen, a practitioner of both Western and Taoist systems of magic, and the author of The Holistic Tarot and The Tao of Craft. Benabel's depth and scope of work and research and its synthesizing and holistic nature make her one of my go-to authorities on Taoist magic, history, and esoteric philosophy. Her unique perspective as a diligent and reliable researcher and experienced practitioner, as well as her intimate knowledge and understanding of the systems in which she practices, make Benabel a true fountain of resources for any practitioner wanting to learn about esoteric theory and practice in either Eastern or Western systems. Today, we spoke about her background, growing up Taiwanese-American in upstate New York, the nature of qi, the many layers of esoteric Taoist texts, her forthcoming book on the Oracle of the Yi Qing, and much more. I'm Ike Baker, and this is the Arcanum Podcast. I appreciate you coming on.
Oh, my pleasure, of course.
Yeah. I'm actually very excited to have you today because I am a fan.
What? So, why?
Well, I grew up here in the States, and for a little while, actually for quite some time, I studied acupuncture and traditional Chinese medicine, so not classical, but and I've also been a practitioner of the Western esoteric traditions. So obviously your work, Holistic Tarot, I think that was 2015.
Yeah.
At this point, it's kind of a little bit of a modern classic. And Tao of Craft has just been something I've been working through. And it's such a resource, not only because it goes through the particulars of the Taoist practice and fully fleshes it out and with as much detail as you would want, but it also informs the Western practice of talismanic magic and sigil crafting, because the gap that I see, the disconnect in having studied energy work and meridian theory and a little tiny smattering of Taoist cosmology, the disconnect is that in Western magic, typically, we dance around, but we don't have this concept of qi.
Mm.
We dance around.
Really? You think so?
I think, some people have fused this idea of this Eastern understanding of things like qi and prana and
I
things
like this. I definitely know nothing about the Kabbalah for sure, so I definitely don't want to give the pretense of knowing anything, but I've heard people make the correlation between qi and, for example, ruach, right?
Ruach, yes, absolutely. But the thing is, there's not any strict sort of utilization of ruach, because while ruach implies breath or air, and has, again, like many of the other words that are sort of synonymous with it in the other traditions, it has an association with spirit. Typically in the Kabbalistic model, at least practical Kabbalism, you're thinking of it more in terms of the constituents of like a practitioner's psyche.
Hmm.
Yeah, so there's definitely that there, but there's not much in the written stuff that really
like
fleshes
shen.
It out.
Because we have shen, qi, and jing, and so shen is like, for example, what's funny is now that we are in modern times, shen became a word that we use to talk about consciousness and the psyche. But then, the older word for it etymologically was spirit.
Really?
Or celestial spirit.
Right, yeah, that's the way they taught it. To me was that Shen is much more the consciousness of the person. So that's pretty interesting. So how do you define qi when people ask you to explain it? That's what I'm curious to know.
How do I define qi?
Yeah.
So one thing is, even in Taoist metaphysics, qi is, even that is a broad strokes term, right? Because it is used to talk about in a very generic umbrella term, many different forms of life force that you might not be able to see with your physical eyes, but you can, a lot of people, we can definitely sense it, right? So there's that chi. But then like how that chi is characterized in very specific instances, then there are different names and different ways of characterizing chi. So in the broad strokes way, I would say chi is just the life force that is driving the movement of the physical bodies, that is the correspondent to the life force behind that. So it's the underpinning force of nature that's giving us, that's making my hand move, that's making me speak to you, that's giving me my thoughts and ideas. And the reason we are having this conversation right now, at some underpinning level, it's that chi, that life force.
Yeah. So I guess it sounds like it's really broadly an animating principle.
Yeah. And I'm also, I mean, because I've heard all in certain conversations and circles, they are having these discussions now in East Asia about chi and its interconnections with dark matter or dark energy. So that's a really new conversation that takes the concept of chi to a different level that obviously didn't exist before.
Yeah, that's incredible. That's excellent. So, you know, I'm very excited. This is a great conversation that I wanted to have for a really long time. There's not many people in my circle that I can talk to about Taoism and things like, you know, qi theory with. But before I get too excited, let me back up a little bit. So would you mind telling maybe anybody who might be listening to this and myself a little bit about your background?
I'm Benabel. I grew up in upstate New York. I'm Taiwanese American. My mom is from a very small place outside of Tainan, which is the rural south of Taiwan. And it's really known, that heartland area is really known for a very robust, you can say superstitious, but a very robust folk practice of traditional Chinese religion, Taoist magic, Taoist mysticism, forms of mediumship, fortune telling, all of that. And then when she came here, she was just a housewife, but within the Taiwanese American community here in the US, she did feng shui, she did fortune telling, and then she found her own little niche of people who then did a lot of other practices in our basement. And that's what I kind of grew up with, just seeing that experience. Who am I? That's pretty much it. Just a occultist slash lawyer who grew up here in the States, but has really close ties to Taiwan because of my parents.
That's great. That's great. And I've been following your video series, and I know that you had mentioned that it was in the 90s that you got kind of involved with, or I think you made the distinction, you began to associate with certain circles in the pagan community.
Oh, yeah, that's true. I think so I really took an intentional, very intentionally tried to distance myself from Taoist magic and Taoist occultism, because when you're young, you just want to fit in, you want to assimilate. And there was such a dissonance between this, you know, history and legacy and heritage that I had and these presumed realities. Like my mom wouldn't even caveat these conversations with, this is my religion or this is my belief or we believe. It was kind of a presumed reality that, you know, the late uncle so-and-so is in the room. It was a presumed reality that gods and demons existed and exorcisms were talked about as it was a real thing. Exorcism and going to the pediatrician were kind of like talked about hand in hand. And so parsing through that in upstate New York was something I really had to do in a very intentional way. But then I think, you know, your heart is where it is. And if whatever you believe in, it kind of follows you. So I thought that I was distancing myself from Taoist magic by going into Western occultism and the Western pagan communities. But then, you know, it's very similar. There's so much overlap.
Yeah. Yeah. Actually, I'm from New York, too. I'm from downstate.
Oh, what part?
Long Island is where I grew up, but I lived in Manhattan for a long time. I kind of had a similar thing going on. Obviously, I was my father's Greek, my mother's Italian, so I was Roman Catholic, and I had a similar situation. A lot of things taken for granted in a religious context that were kind of, I don't know, they're lay metaphysical, you know, like it's like the laity talking about metaphysics, which is it just ends up being spooky. Same thing, you know, I thought I was getting away from that sort of thing, but it does follow you, because I think one of the things that gets impressed on people who are exposed to spirituality at a young age is some sort of connection. At least it can happen, you know, a connection to that other side of things. And also, I think, you know, there's a long, I guess, grimoire tradition in the Western paganism that actually comes from Christian clergy. You know, a lot of that was written by them. But how do your Taoist upbringing and your forays in Western esoteric or pagan traditions, how do they meet now? Is there a practical sort of way that you express these two very, very unique and very interesting combinations?
I think one way they met that I'm wondering how I can untangle actually is, you know, I don't want to say scientific method, but, you know, we are heavily influenced by a lot of the concepts and philosophies and approaches to reality that came out of the Enlightenment era. You know, that concept of how we approach understanding and parsing through reality, how we talk about ideas even. And so, for example, the grimoire tradition, this idea of it's not true until you write it down, or the importance of writing. And while there has always been an emphasis on the importance of writing, for example, in talismanic magic in East Asian traditions, the grimoire tradition is not quite as strong, you know? And so especially on the ground level, practical level, a lot of practitioners, I just don't see them having this grimoire tradition, and it's not really passed down. And when we say grimoire, Taoist grimoires, we're often talking about like canons and scripture. And so it's very complex, right? Like, is it a grimoire? Is it not? I don't know how to describe what we have in terms of Daozang or Taoist canons in the Eastern traditions. So, and I think bringing in a lot of the how I process information from a Western upbringing, I've applied to Eastern esoteric traditions. But then now I'm in this stage where I wonder if I want to try to unpack that and go back to understanding oral traditions. You see a lot of problems arising actually because of, you know, Western ideas of from the Enlightenment being applied to Eastern oral traditions.
Yeah, it's definitely a sticking point that permeates all kind of metaphysical or magical endeavor. And I think recently I described it as sort of... And Eliphas Levy, if you're familiar with him, the French occultist, he said something kind of on the nose about this, but in his very ornamental way that he spoke and wrote. You know, asking someone for a sort of scientific proof of spirituality is like asking someone to speak in colors. The domains can't really fully penetrate into each other in terms of this underlying explanation. You know, I mean, they're called the mysteries for a reason, right? And they have been for centuries. So I also find that there is a period of, I guess, re-education or divesting yourself of these ideas to whatever extent is possible for you at the time in order to allow yourself to experience the reality of magic, you know, because if you've got all these sort of walls built up, these rational arguments against it a priori, it really hinders your ability to experience it. It's kind of a self-fulfilling prophecy.
One of the things I do appreciate a lot about Western occultism, especially figures like Eliphas Levy, Crowley too, they had written expressions of appreciation for Eastern mysticism. They talked a lot about that. You know, Eliphas Levy in Transcendental Magic, he wrote about the trigrams of Fuxi. Well, Fohi, he called it, but like he wrote about the I Ching essentially.
Yeah, the more I learn about it, because there's this wall at least in my experience. I don't know that that's the case everywhere, but in the Western educational institutions which disseminate or train ACU students, Qi is this very mystical thing, and it kind of stops there. You know, it's very rare that you'll get into research about ghost points and sort of the mathematical metaphysics of the Bagua and all this stuff. And what I really enjoy is how in depth you cover all these things in your video series. I kind of feel like I've been trying to do for Western occultism what you're doing for esoteric Taoism, and sometimes I scratch my head. I'm like, wow, she makes me sound like a child.
No, not at all.
But it's been pretty excellent to watch that, and I just want to take a minute actually, and I can't recommend that video, your video series, enough. It's just Benabel Wen on YouTube,
Yeah,
correct?
thank you so much.
Yeah, absolutely.
But to the point that you were just making, it's fascinating. One thing that I realized recently, Huang Di Nei Jing, I think it's Yellow Emperor's Inner
Classic,
Canons. It's something I know it's pretty much a gospel text for acupuncture students and people in the West who are learning traditional Chinese medicine. But what I learned was their reading of it is only on that traditional Chinese medicine level, the more, I guess, holistic clinical level. I don't want to use the word clinical too loosely, but yeah, it is that treatment level. But then that was really not the understanding I had of the text. I mean, I knew it was, of course, on traditional Chinese medicine, but I'd always known that so in Chinese, every word has multiple meanings. And so the understanding was you read the text on one level, which is about healing and the metaphysics of traditional Chinese medicine, acupuncture, how qi flows through the five movements. But then on another level, it's the best way I can actually use to describe it is the Akashic Records. It's this idea of being having access through the five agents to an all-knowing source of knowledge and being able to use divination in a way that helps to diagnose and proceed with healing methods. But I never hear people in the West talk about that underlying layer of interpreting that particular text.
I and one of the things that really has stuck out to me is, yeah, we have this, and it's not necessarily a bad thing, right? Because it kind of pulled us out of a lot of superstition to the point now where scientific vernacular is sort of reaching this return arc on the cycle of time towards the mystical and transcendental. So, you know, hopefully at some point they'll rejoin into their proper union, but we do have this very nominalist Aristotelian Cartesian training that's just ingrained. It's just taken for granted in the West. And so what happens is it stunts symbolic thinking, right? I mean, you can't think on multiple levels. It has to be this or that. And the brilliance behind studying something like Chinese, even to the very superficial level that I did, is that you learn that, wow, there can be multiple layers to this stuff.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think what I find, actually what's interesting is in the East, we do also have this new embedded culture of the scientific method and being more rational based. And that's brought on a lot by, the Cultural Revolution and more recent turning points in socio geopolitics in Asia. But yeah, I mean, to be fair, right? Asia is losing that as well. So it's not like a Western problem. I think it's a global, it's just like a human problem where we are moving more heavily into the realm of rationalism. But like you said, like you intuited, we've kind of reached a tipping point in the extreme, that end of rationalism, that you do see that return or this cycle back to mysticism, especially in the new conversations physicists are having on, quantum physics. I know people hate it when you talk about quantum physics and occultism, right? But you even see that in the scientific community, these conversations happening right now on quantum states.
I mean, I think it's a perfect marriage, even if you know, it's kind of murky and not everything fits together just yet. I think that's a fusion that is worth attempting at this point, you know, because it's like we're so close, but
I agree too. I mean, I acknowledge we can be clunky with our vernacular when we're talking about, that intersection between occultism and quantum physics. Of course, we're clunky with the way we talk about it, But having those conversations, making those mistakes now is really important.
Right. And it really, at the end of the day, at least I think for practitioners, people who have a gnosis and experience of this stuff, you know, we understand how similar the two really are at the core. A lot of people might make the mistake that we're doing sort of Harry Potter movie magics type of stuff, but it's really not. If anything, I think the heart of everything is revolving toward consciousness, you know, in a way that is, it transcends sort of this individualized human self-awareness. It's the consciousness that permeates everything. You know, it's very important. I think that's at the heart of the quantum problem right now, and also with magic.
Yeah, and I think right now I'm still trying to grapple and understand the Taoist metaphysical philosophy on this, because I don't think I fully understand it. But the basic premise of it is that space-time is not linear. And this is something that's old as hat in Taoist mysticism. It's not linear, it's a spiral. And because it's this spiraling cycle, it hits on multiple dimensional levels at the same time. And we can only experience one level at any given time because of the limitations of human perception. But it's causing all sorts of things happening at different levels at the exact moment we're experiencing it. So we experience it in a linear way, but it's actually a spiral hitting multi dimensions. I keep going back to the Kabbalah only because I had a very, very recent personal conversation with a friend who was a practitioner. But like, it's that idea, right, of the Sephiroth, the 10 Sephiroth hitting on four dimensions of the four Kabbalistic worlds. There's something to it. If so many different traditions are coming to the same idea, of course, using the language of their own culture, but they're still coming to the same fundamental ideas. I just wonder why that's not worth exploring.
Yeah, there is a treasure trove of almost every cultural background or heritage. You know, they've left us with symbol systems. Mm-hmm. If anything, that we can, if we really dig in and learn to experience them, I think that we can sort of bring them back and restore them and put them to good use. But one of the interesting things about, for me, about you know, Taoism and the energy work practices of Qigong and things of that sort is they do give you an experiential component. If you stick with them long enough, you begin to feel qi, and it's quite a remarkable thing. And I'm sure that there are people in the Western esoteric paradigm who have had similar experiences, but I would say far and away the Taoist practices, as I guess potentially diluted as they are, having come down to us in the West, are incredible for that. The tradition of practice that was also passed on is invaluable.
My mom gave me a great metaphor. I can't remember what it's called. This is from the 90s. Remember those groovy maps? Like, it's all these different colors, and then you look into it. Some people can see things, other people can't, right? And then, so my mom, you know, it was popular in the 90s. So my mom actually used that to explain something to me once. So, you know, a lot of us, most of us cannot see the thing, you know, that picture, that three-dimensional picture in that groovy color scheme. And then, however, once someone points it out to you, you can't unsee it, right? You absolutely see it in there. And so I think certain cultures, for example, if you grow up knowing to see certain things, you'll never unsee it from your reality because it is there. It's always been there. It's just that some people, most of us who only look at that groovy picture, you can't see the three-dimensional image embedded into it because you don't have, like, people haven't shown it to you. You don't have sort of like the basic skill sets innate in you to see it because you weren't brought up with that. So that was a great metaphor for example, experiencing qi.
Yeah, that's an excellent metaphor. Way to go, Mom. So I know a few practitioners of Taoist, I guess you would call it internal alchemy, or at least the version that is available to us here in the mountains in North Carolina. But I get differing opinions when I broached the subject of Taoist magic. Mm. You know, some people think that are of the opinion that there is not a similar concept in at least maybe modern China, as we have now in the West to magic and things like that. And I don't know that that's 100% true, but the operative words there being, I don't know. So I was wondering if, you know, if you could expound on that a little bit, you know.
I guess it depends on how you're defining Taoist magic. If you're talking about a ritualistic, a heavily ritualized process with lots of, bells and whistles, where, you have, like, in a more superficial way of expressing it, you have to have like this particular tool made on this day when this moon is up with these stars aligned in a certain way and facing east, right? Like, and how you're supposed to create these tools and how the tools are used and drawing particular diagrams, spirit diagrams on the ground and pacing through the diagrams on the ground in a specific way to invoke a particular type of divine being or spirit, either in a world that's more celestial or a world that we might equate to demonic or an underworld of some kind or a hungry ghost. Absolutely, that's a very vibrant practice. I think one thing is, it depends on where you go. You see it more heavily prevalent in Southeast Asia now. The Chinese diasporic communities in Taiwan, Hong Kong, and places where, like, I don't want to get into politics, but like places where communism hasn't touched, like, and I just don't want to go there, but like there is a reality to that
Right.
point, and
Absolutely.
you see a lot of, very, very vibrant shamanic practices in Japan as well. So places that are untouched by a particular evolution of thinking and philosophy that diverges very extremely from these original folk practices. Yeah, it's still very vibrant. That was actually the culture that I grew up in because I grew up untouched by the geopolitics of Asia.
Yes, I remember in one of your videos you had mentioned about not necessarily being the go-to in China to refer to yourself or identify yourself as a Taoist in terms of religion rather than Buddhism. And it was such a funny visual that you had given, because people will apparently immediately think of somebody like wearing a sorcerer's hat and doing strange mudras and dances and things like that.
Like that is a reality. It's, I mean, if you don't know what you're looking at, that's what it looks like. I'll be fair.
Yeah, I mean, I do that.
Exactly. We have to have a sense of humor about what we do.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. You've got a new book coming out. Has it come out yet, or is it on its way?
It's on its way. I mean, it's written. It's been written for a while now. So, if you, I mean, you know how as the author it feels weird, right? Yeah. So it's coming out June 2023.
Beautiful. And that's on the I Ching.
Yeah, it's on the I Ching. But I like to talk about how the original intention, what I wanted to do before I started writing, was I wanted to write. I guess I'll use the word grimoire, but I wanted to write a book on Taoist magical practices and mystical practices. And then I was like, how am I going to do that? And I decided to do that through the framework of the I Ching, but then also combine it with my translations and annotations of the I Ching and really go in and do the research into Chinese texts on how these passages were actually interpreted in Asia, not, sort of untouched by Wilhelm, for example. Wilhelm and like, to be fair.
Yeah, that sounds fascinating actually. Again, I think you were talking about sort of the mathematical metaphysics of the whole schema of the trigrams the Lo Shu square, which is mind-blowing, right? Because we have that in the Western tradition. It's the square of Saturn. And it's just that's something that I'm extremely interested in. How much of that can we look forward to in your new book?
Not that much. The Luoshu is the one of the prem. I mean, it's the mathematical premise of the I Ching, and it's also a part of the Ten Wings. So that part of it is in there because it has to be. But not anything more beyond the video that I made. Or yeah, that's not too much because I still focus on the 64 hexagrams.
And I'm assuming you have an I Ching practice. You do it daily or.
I Ching practice. I don't do it daily because of my relationship with the I Ching. For me, I read it pretty routinely, but I read it the way people would read scripture. It's a meditation. So the text is to help you cultivate a transcendental understanding of the world. So there is, it's a book of wisdom. And so I treat it like a book of wisdom where I'm reading it more as a spiritual practice, as a form of cultivation, to purify your chi in another way of speaking. In terms of divination, for me personally, how I approach it is I can be a little bit more irreverent and fun with, for example, the tarot, right? But for the I Ching, I just feel like for me, at this point in my life, I won't go to the I Ching for divination unless it's a very serious question. And then I take it very seriously. And it's a whole ritualized process for going to the I Ching for answers.
I came up in the system of, well, I learned esotericism and magic really in the system of the Hermetic Order of the Golden Dawn, which is still very much alive and well here. And that's exactly what we do. That's the way we learn divination is ritualized divination. And one of the things that was so interesting to me in the Tao of Craft was the idea of the charging, the sort of consecration ritual that had to take place, which is so antithetical to so much chaos magic that's out there right now. And that's not to be disparaging about it, because there's a component of that stuff that is very effective. But it's just a whole nother level when you incorporate ritual into something, and you begin to sort of stabilize and add controls to your sort of divinatory experiment.
That's actually a very important point or principle in, I guess, the Taoist traditions and East Asian traditions, to be completely fair. It's that idea of kai guang and purifying and consecration, and it's on multiple levels. So there's also a very strong presumption that the practitioner should be purifying the self as well. So you need to consecrate yourself on many different levels before you approach spirit. And that's just a form of reverence. And it's also to attune yourself more strongly to the resonance of spirit. So that's a very important principle in Taoist mysticism is consecration.
And I've heard it from certain Taoist or Qigong practitioners that they undergo a very strict regimen of meditation and taking care of what they eat and managing their stress levels, simply because if they're working on someone else's qi, how their qi needs to be as good as they can get it. So perhaps a similar sort of corollary there. But I've seen on your social media that you really enjoy cooking.
I do.
Yeah, absolutely. It's got to be a cultural thing as well. And same for me. But I'm wondering how much does that play into your, I guess, spiritual pursuits on a holistic level. I know very much so that the underlying philosophy behind much of Chinese medicine is to, you have the proper balance of hot and cold and these kind of temperatures. And even in the Wang Di Nei Ching, he starts out by saying to eat seasonally, and that kind of stuff. But also in terms of herbalism, that's a huge tradition, decoctions and things like that. Do you incorporate any of that?
Absolutely, but I don't see it as spiritual. I just see it as practical. It's sort of like my lifestyle. I don't know how else to explain it. So we grow our own food, grow our own fruits and vegetables. I would like to raise chickens, but we currently have zoning and code issues, so I can't raise chickens here. But I really try very hard to grow my own foods, and when it's all organic, even the way I approach it, this is gonna sound crazy. I talk to my trees, I talk to my plants. I'm really thoughtful about moon phases in terms of harvesting and sowing. And then when you receive the fruits from the trees, or when you have to cut the leaves from the plants, there's a ritualized way to do that, to be honored, to be respectful and grateful for what you're receiving. How you cook, how you prepare, all of that is very important. Thinking, you know, positive thoughts. Like when you say cook with love, I think it's a concept everybody knows intuitively. So I put it simply, I cook with love. You know, that's really how I would put it. And then understanding the body constitutions of who I'm cooking for. So that would be my husband and my father-in-law, myself as well. And we really are mindful of body constitution, making sure they're not eating too much hot foods. And I'm making sure I'm not eating too much cold foods. So these are all things that I kind of think about, but I don't think about it as a spiritual practice. It's like, if you're wondering about how much protein you're eating, if you're worried about your blood panel, is that your spiritual practice? You know, if you're worried about nutritional balance of your diet, I don't see that necessarily as a spiritual practice.
Yeah. And I guess you're the more lucky for it. yeah, it's been definitely something that I've had to consciously pay attention to, just because it's not the system I grew up in, that kind of medicine. But yeah, I mean, that's a really important point. We can kind of get lost in all the magic and the fanciful talk of chi, but at the core of all of it, you know, this self-care as just lifestyle and as a sort of respectful communal endeavor with your environment. Yeah, that definitely, I guess it includes and transcends the purely spiritual. Absolutely. That's a good point, actually. So I'm wondering, is there a place where anyone could pre-order the book that you have coming out, or is it going to be on Amazon? Will you be selling it from your websites, or?
No, I don't sell it directly. Amazon, I think, any place that you normally buy books, you can buy it from Penguin Random House or North Atlantic Books directly if you'd like. But yeah, any normal place you would go, hopefully it's at the local bookstore as well. So if it's not, go and request it. Right.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. There's a couple of sort of stock questions that I ask everybody who comes on the podcast. So sometimes I give them a heads up because I know some people will choke. I didn't really get a chance to give you a heads up on this one.
No
but
worries. Let's have fun.
Yeah. So I like to ask people, how do you experience magic? I used to ask them, how do you define it? But I like to ask, how do you experience magic?
How do I experience magic? I think for starters, I think it depends on what age you asked me this question. At this age where I am now, I don't characterize it as magic. I characterize it as now it's just my reality. It's me understanding there is an unseen counterpart to the thing that I can physically experience. And it's connected to my reality. And so being cognizant that there are other forms of beings around me, other than what we use, like humans, animals, whatnot, there are other forms of beings around us that are the way they are for various reasons. They were born from a different realm, or, you know, it's a ghost, right? It's a deceased person. So these are all things that I just kind of am mindful of. And so that's my magical practice, I think, you know, is just being mindful that there's a lot more than what we say we know and what the scientific experts of our world say we know. And I'm just mindful of that. But I don't expect anybody else to believe me.
Right. Yeah. I mean, that's, I think it's very important that people such as yourself and some of the other people that I've had on the podcast continue to operate in the milieu in which you currently do, because there was a period where it was kind of arid in terms of the literature that was coming out. And, it was a lot of heart and not as much head, not as much, I guess grounding in the research of traditions and things like that. But we've got a lot of that now, but we don't have a ton of it from a practitioner standpoint. And
yeah,
and I think it's really important that we continue to, use our voices to contribute that perspective for other would-be practitioners or you know, people who are just looking for a venue to have an open mind and not feel silly, you know, about it.
It's very hard, you know, because I think when you go about it in a very folk religious way that does not feel any necessity to ground it in rationalism, you have a community for that, right? You have a community that will embrace you for that. And if you approach it purely as an academic exercise, purely in terms of scholarship that follows the conventions of academia, there's also a community for that as well. But if you try to bridge that gap, you're going to get flack from both sides and suddenly you are without community.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, that's a big motivating factor for me wanting to do this podcast, is not only to share my perspective, but to get people like yourself a platform, because I really do view, from what I know of both of them, which is probably paltry little, but that's fine because I'm able to practically apply it, right? They're two sides of one coin, the more Eastern conception and West. After all, it's one earth, you know, it's one humanity, and there's been a lot of cross-pollination. But I think that a lot of Western practitioners, people that are actually trying to use this stuff, could very much benefit from all of your work. But for people who kind of feel lost in the weeds and maybe don't know where to have a starting point, didn't have the benefit of kind of wandering into an acupuncture school the way I did, would you be able to list maybe three books or even from any kind of media, documentary series, a YouTube channel that you would recommend for people who have listened to our conversation today and want to know more?
Wow. You know, I feel so bad that I don't know any. Like, I have recommendations for the advanced Taoist practitioner, like what books to read if you really want to deep dive into Taoist alchemy. But like beginner level books in English, I mean, even in Chinese, I can't even recommend books in Chinese, let alone books in English. That's a really tough one. I don't know.
How about for the advanced practitioner? Because I'm not technically advanced, but I want to get my hands on those books. So.
I think a great place to start is the Daozang, the Taoist canons. It's not one book. Taoist canons is kind of like, what is it, Nag Hammadi's, this idea of like the Dead Sea Scrolls, very similar. Like, what is the Taoist canons? What's not? That's like up for debate among scholars. But basically, when you get into the realm of that portfolio of texts, you're going to find a lot of old traditions that have really been well preserved, as long as you don't find the forgeries, right? But really well preserved canons on ritual magic. What you were saying, you asked the question, is there really a vibrant practice of ceremonial magic in Asia? Well, the Taoist canons will absolutely answer that question for you in the affirmative, a resounding yes, and show you exactly how. Meditative practices. So that's really important. I like Huangdi Ying Fujing, the Yellow Emperor's Yin, Mysteries of the Hidden Talisman or something like that is how I think people translate it. But that's a really good one because it gives you the metaphysical framework for how to do ritual magic. And then it does give you a lot about like the mechanisms of ritual magic as well. So those are two really good texts to start.
Yeah. And I think Tao of Craft had a translation that you rendered of that, correct?
A little piece of it. It's not so much a translation, but a summary. So I read through the whole text because it is dense reading material. Like you're not going to, if you read that straightforward, you might not pick up on the 13 points that I brought up unless you read and reread and read it. But this sort of core summary of the text is what I pulled out of it and put in the Tao of Craft. So.
Excellent. So is there anything else that, that you've got going on that you, you might want to plug or alert people to?
So right now, what I'm really interested in is that YouTube channel that I have going, putting up a series of videos on, those are beginner level videos. I try very hard to make it beginner level videos that will introduce you to Taoist metaphysics and ritual magic. I mean, it's in the nascent stages of the series. So you see more principle oriented, but I do want to eventually get to more practical oriented aspects of beginner level Taoist magic. So that's why I would like to plug that.
Yeah, I mean that's been a boon for me. I have to drive really far in the mornings to and the evenings to and from work. So I have plenty of time to just sit back and listen.
That's awesome.
Yeah, and it's been an excellent series. I mean, yeah, for beginner videos, there's some mind-blowing stuff on there. I would highly recommend it. Now, I guess a final question I have, because it kind of popped into my head. Do you think that, and I know this is going to be very subjective to each practitioner, but do you think somebody like me, who's very interested in Taoism and has some experience with meridian theory and the philosophy, right? I read Tao Te Ching many times, starting when I was very young. I think it was like 15 when I read it. And do you think that there is any way for a Westerner such as myself to really connect with the traditions of Taoism and turn it into a as beautiful and as deep a tradition as I know it can go?
Yeah, absolutely. I don't, I mean, you're right. It's a subject. I don't want to, draw lines in the sand, and people have their different perspectives. But for me, it's within the perspective of Taoism. So from the Taoist perspective, there is a gauntlet that you have to run in order to truly achieve understanding. And it doesn't matter what you look like, who you are, what your background is. And it is true. We do start, it's an unequal, unlevel playing field that we all begin on. That's called life. That's not just a race thing. That's not a culture thing, East versus West. I mean, socioeconomics, we all begin on different, we're not all privileged, right? And so no
Right.
matter where you begin, where from that starting point, if you're willing to run the gauntlet and say, I don't care how unfair my place is, I'm willing to go forward and try to understand this. The gods will answer, and you will absolutely be able to achieve understanding.
Wonderful. That's extremely encouraging. Thank you so much for having a conversation with me today. It's an absolute pleasure. I'm looking forward to everything that you have going on right now, and I hope to speak to you again.
My pleasure. Thank you so much.
Take care.
Take care. Bye.